So hello everybody, I'm Sébastien Fay. I'm Sébastien Fay, so I work on traffic light control and traffic management with Claude Chaudet and Isabelle Demeure. And today we consider the problem of controlling the traffic light using a wireless sensor network. So as you can imagine, this kind of network is complex to manage and can generate accident, traffic jam, and therefore a waste of time and money. For example, according to the INRIX Institute, last year a driver wasted on average 60 hours in congestion. This is huge. As a solution, and classically the management of this problem are centralized in a control center, which developed since several years intelligent transportation system, making the driver experience better, faster, and safer. So here we will study the traffic light in the, with intelligent transportation system. This is one of the key of the urban road management. So here you have the usable intersection model, classically used in the literature. It is composed of four directions, so north, east, west, and south, and eight main movements. One movement is defined by source direction and the destination direction. For example, this movement is N, is the movement which begins in the south and which going to the north. In addition to four movements going right, not represented here. One intersection has classically one controller, which sequence the green light into cycle of several phases. So here you have an example of predetermined sequences, or a cycle, or a traffic light plan. And it defines for each movement or couple of movement when and for how long the green light will begin. With the intelligent transportation system, we can react to traffic variation and improve the user waiting time. So this is the usual adaptive intersection model. We use classically two measurement points or sensor per lane for this kind of model. So the first one is to detect the arrival and the intersection, and the second one is to detect the departure. With this information, we can compute easily the repartition of the vehicle on the intersection and take a decision on the traffic light. In the literature, authors using such model have some weaknesses. So first, the decision are centralized in a base station. That is to say, all the sensors send air data to the base station, which act as a decider. So the question is, why not let the sensor cooperate to prevent, for example, the fault tolerance, to report the cost, to work on an isolated system, or simply to remove the base station itself. The next, the queue sizes, that is to say the number of vehicles, is the only parameter. This can lead to starvation problem. A lane with a few vehicles is not treated because of most charged, most loaded lane. Next, one decision is taken by cycle. This is not sufficient in regard of the real-time uncertainty of the traffic, because one cycle, it can be long, on average 90 seconds. And some authors use unrealistic assumption, especially in multiple intersection cases, like the same type of vehicle and the same speed for all the vehicles. So here we propose a more reactive algorithm which works at the fast granularity. We propose to consider starvation in addition to queue sizes. we propose a multiple intersection algorithm which affect the local objective. And finally, to distribute the decision instead of relying on the base station. This the adaptation we want need reactive equipment, which are generally expensive, need important space or hard work, like the induction loop or radar. So here we propose to use the wireless sensor network, which are inexpensive, which are very small, which have computation and memory unit, and can act as the as a decider to the on our architecture. So here is the architecture we propose, and it is composed of four communication layers. The first layer is in green, it contains the arrival. The second layer is in all the nodes in red, it contains the departure. Over this second layer, we define for each direction an aggregator that aggregates data from each direction. And over all the red node, we define one decision point which aggregates data from all the direction and which take a decision on the next green light. Then when the decision is taken, the decision point have just to send to the controller the decision via a simple interface instead of a base station. So based on this architecture, we define a multiple intersection algorithm called Tapioca. So this is an adapted and distributed traffic light control algorithm. This algorithm is designed to select movement with a local score function locally on each intersection. This process is called for each phases and consider the queue sizes, that is to say the number of vehicles, and the starvation, that is to say the last time one light was selected. In addition to compute locally a score, our algorithm try to synchronize all the adjacent intersection and try to create green wave, that is to say successive paths of green light. And this synchronization depends on the number of vehicles each intersection has. For example, this intersection is more loaded than this intersection. So this intersection will open its light and a path is created. In the first step, we evaluate Tapioca. With Sumo. So here we do not consider the wireless communication and we perform our simulation on the Tapascalon dataset, which is assumed to be one of the largest, if not the largest, freely available traffic simulation dataset. Here you can see two main results. So the first show the average queue length for three methods. The first is Tapioca, the second is Youssef Féol algorithm, this is a concurrent algorithm from the literature, and the third is a predetermined traffic light plan from Sumo and Tapascalon. So we can see that our algorithm generates the lowest average queue length. And in the second graphic, we can see the cumulative distribution function of the average waiting time. So this is not. I don't see if you see. I don't want. Yes? So you can see that Tapioca generates the lowest average waiting time than Youssef and all, and Tapascalon dataset. So this is just two results, but all the results are available online in the on this address. In a second step, we want to introduce the wireless communication effect. So we develop a co-simulation with the help of the VENS framework, which link Sumo and Omnet, a network simulator. So here, each sensor is deployed with the 802.54 standard for communication, which seems for us the most natural for fixed sensor, but other standards can be easily used. We define for this co-simulation a feeding strategy. The way the information goes from the green node to the decision node. So we define two timers. The first is on the arrival node and send periodically. Each green node sends periodically the arrival to the direction aggregator. And on the second timer, the second timer is on the direction aggregator and sends periodically the aggregated data to the decision point, which can make a decision. So based on our co-simulation architecture, we simulate the average delay and the average accounting error in terms of number of vehicles. So here we can see for a different seed of SN and DN timer that the delay, that is to say the difference between when a detection is made and is used by the decision point is on average, for example, for 16, for a SN timer of 16 and a DN timer of 16, is on average 10 seconds, which can make a big accounting error. If we see here the same, we have 25 accounting errors. So the delay and the packet losses consequences are huge, potentially.
So just a question, so the delay, yes? What delay?
What?
Before you were saying the delay was basically the QI time, the guy that was driving.
In fact, this is the difference between the time when a measure is taken here and this same measure is used here. So,
if you go next slide, go to the next slide, just to understand.
Yeah.
So if I have an SN timer of 1 second and I have a DN timer of 64, how can the delay be 16? So just to be sure, what are you showing us?
With a DN timer of...
Repeat the red box, which is in the most leftmost edge.
Yeah.
So SN equal to 1 and DN equal to 64.
Is it?
Yeah, this thing there.
Okay.
Red one.
Okay.
Yeah. So DN time equal to 64 means that the decision node takes a...
Yes, it takes a decision from receive the information every 64 seconds.
But if the guy is sending, so the sensor is sending, pushing data every second.
Yes.
Then there is the intermediate. Is there any timer that makes it so, I mean, decisions are taken after 16 seconds? So it was just because I see there is it's constant until the very last, and then it bumps to 64. Then I'm not understanding why this happened, and so what is the relation between the two timers?
Okay. In fact, the two timers are not synchronous. Maybe we can talk after because.
I'm sure we are not showing also. But this is the average delay, so I'm looking at the code to be sure, but I think there is a, you receive you receive the all the 1 second samples from the SM from the deepest sensors. And then you can put a big packet or a negative packet that after the average delay between the measurement and the collection point could be 64 seconds plus 63 plus 62 plus average of 64, 63, 62, and so on. I think this is something like this. And as the two timers are not synchronized, I think the average should give something like this. But to check exactly, I think this is what we see.
Just a question, I didn't understand what is the accounting error.
This is in terms of number of vehicles.
Okay.
In fact, the fact we have a delay, we have consequences on the decision node and accounting error on the number of vehicles it really have.
This is an error due to the algorithm that you are using?
This is due to the delay, in fact. Yeah. So the lowest is the timer, and the lowest the accounting error is. So to alleviate this problem, we propose a prediction mechanism based on a WMA model. So in addition to send the arrival and the departure on the two first layer communication layer, we send the arrival rate and the departure rate, and with this information, the decision point can adjust the total vehicle estimation it has. And here we can see the result of our simulation with and without our prediction mechanism. So we can see in green our algorithm with the prediction mechanism, and in red the average waiting time of our algorithm without the prediction mechanism. So we can see that the average waiting time is better when the prediction mechanism is enabled. But our prediction mechanism work well except in a certain case, so two cases, when the timer are too low because there are more interference and packet loss. So the average waiting time grow. And the second case is when the timer is too high. So here you can see a zoom of a method. Here you can see the Sumo traffic light control plane. Here, Tapioca without any notion of communication. Here, a concurrent algorithm. And here, the Tapioca with and without our prediction mechanism.
Thank you.
Second question.
Yes.
So Sumo TNC in the picture on the left seems to be on about 20 seconds.
Yeah.
Why on the left, on the right, it becomes 40 seconds?
Mm-hmm. A plot error, maybe? A plot error, yes. The rail data is here. But, yes. This is a plot error, I think. So you can see here that Sumo in gray has the highest average waiting time. But all the results are available online, the real result. So you can go on the website and see by yourself. So to conclude, now we want to enjoy the flexibility of the distributed architecture and propose a deconstruction algorithm for the congestion case. So here we can see a simulation with Sumo. Where we send a lot of vehicles for 1 hour, and in consequences we have a huge congested traffic. So we plan to deconstruct efficiently this case. And as a second part, we plan to improve the communication study with, for example, dynamic timer to reduce the communication cost. So that's all. If you have a question.
Can you go to the results slides? The last
one. This one?
So, so without the prediction, the tapioca is, as far as I can understand, is worse than the sumo or the Youssef's result, right?
Yes.
So you can say that you have to use the prediction.
Yes. Because without prediction, you have your estimation and the number of vehicles is false, isn't true. So this is not an optimal decision.
Okay. So I mean, I'm a bit confused about how big the difference is between the prediction and the no prediction cases.
Mm-hmm.
The difference is too much.
Because without prediction, we have a lot of accounting error on the number of vehicles, and the decision is take on data which are not real, which are not current. So so.
Even with the prediction, it is worse than the centralized, as I can understand, right? Even with the prediction, the green ones,
yeah,
is worse than the centralized tapioca.
Yeah.
So why, for example, why do you think that a person should choose a non-centralized method? Just due to the costs?
No, because from here, the tapioca, the centralized version of tapioca, is do not consider the communication aspect, but in reality you have to consider this aspect, maybe with a wireless sensor network, maybe with other equipment, but here the centralized version of tapioca it's no realist, isn't realist.
In fact, the Sumo TLC, the first tapioca and Youssef are with idealistic communication layers, which means that you have no loss, you have no throughput effects, and this one.
Ah, it's like lower bounds.
Yes, somehow, yeah. That's why the centralized tapioca is so much more centralized.
Okay.
The leftmost tapioca is much, so much better because you don't lose any packet. So you are always have the perfect estimation, nothing is late.
Ah,
and so
okay.
On. So in this case, if you add the communication layer of the speed at first, and show the prediction, then you compensate the risk. It's the idea.
So it's not realistic. Actually,
the
centralized.
The three leftmost ones are not realistic.
Okay.
Well, this is the lower bound. This is what we could achieve if we had the perfect.
The learning. I see, okay.
And does it mean that Youssef and all, Sumo and so on, cannot be implemented in reality since they are centralized?
It can be implemented, and we plan to implement this algorithm, but the goal of this presentation is just to show the prediction mechanism.
But you say that to realize this approach, you need to have distributed mechanisms.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And if my understanding is correct, Youssef and all and Sumo are centralized. So you are the only one to propose a realistic solution?
No, this is real. Youssef and all and the other algorithms are realized, but are only simulated on an ETS simulator, on an intelligent transportation system simulator, and the communication layer don't exist.
Okay.
So we have to implement them.
For the Sumo TLC, do you need a communication layer?
No, not really, but
for the Youssef et al.
Yes, for Youssef and all, and for the other tapioca, but sumo is predetermined, is a static, so it don't need communication layer.
I have a question about in your system. You have a green and red sensor.
Mm-hmm.
Green is to detect new vehicles.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the red is just the departure.
Yes.
What is the distance you consider between both points?
The distance varies depending on the arrival rate. In fact, the distance can be computed based on the
physically located.
Physically? The distance of the this.
When you just be here. No. I just need to have here, for example. So you have the red.
Mm-hmm.
The red square.
Yeah.
The green square.
Yeah, the distance here.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is the literature considers that this distance is fixed to 70 meters, but generally it depends on the engineer, the road engineer. And the number of lane and the traffic repartition.
Yes. Yeah, but it was first question for another one. Yeah, I'm just wondering about the accuracy of the sensors,
mm-hmm.
of the system. There are maybe several issues in terms of in the counting of the cars,
mm-hmm.
between these two points. Do you take into account also that the fact that the sensor may not be accurate? I don't know how they work really, so
mm-hmm.
this is the main problem. And they may miss some cars or count in double some cars or miss cars or any other vehicles. So
mm-hmm.
Do you take this into account? And there is also another issue I am thinking about. I asked this question first. The first question is that you may have a car that is arriving on the green and then just stop because you want to go to a parking or a park car that is on the street.
Mm-hmm.
So he stops and he will not departure. So
mm-hmm.
This is also another source of wrongly counting the number of cars between the two points.
Okay.
Are you taking into account this effect?
So for the first question, the detection performance on one sensor is approximately 99%, according to Cheng et al. The only problem that we can have is for the moto,
yeah.
Moto, and for the car, there is no problem. And for the second question, in fact, it depends on the distance of the sensor. But in the worst case, one or two vehicles disappear from the system, and this not affect.
I don't get all the details of what you are doing,
mm-hmm.
but how do you, your modeling is like a queue,
mm-hmm.
so it is a bit like if in a queue system, you don't know exactly how many, you may be wrong on the number of packets you have within your queue, so do you take this into account somehow?
Mm-hmm.
Because you will miss some cars, you may be wrong saying that there is no cars, but there is one.
Not yet.
Okay.
I think there are models like this. There's a lot of works about queue networks and so on, traffic management. It's just for people who do some real traffic management to see what they use. Maybe they account for prediction error.
It's not a prediction error, it is a detection error.
I think that the good point that we have is that we have a detail which can view almost the whole time. So we can always reinitialize the detection. So you take one state and then after 10 minutes you just erase everything. So you don't accumulate errors over time. That's the good point. So that you can have some deviation from what you planned in the beginning of the field.
I like trace-driven simulation, but I have a question about this. I do not know this FUMO trace.
Mm-hmm.
So the problem with trace-driven simulation is that arrivals are okay, then you have your traffic light that changes the way the traffic behaves.
Mm-hmm.
So we slow down one car. So in the trace, the original trace, that car would have arrived at a given intersection at a given time. But in your modified system, since you have stopped that car by telling that traffic went to red, this should impact somehow the arrivals. So I'm not sure what is, if you could describe a little bit how the Sumo TLC work. Okay, so the thing we're saying is that is that data set. And data set is just three, then traffic lights.
Exactly, three traffic lights and traffic measures.
Okay, so it's a traffic map. Okay. And the traffic moves like?
Well, you have the young trees at the incoming road, and then the traffic lights probably see all the traffic lights on the street. They will get the connection line.
Okay, but vehicle moves like, no, it's not random waypoint, but they move fixed speed between the two intersections.
I think it's based on a trace, meaning that they monitor the Cologne city. Mm-hmm. I don't know if they monitor only the lights or also the traffic. But either they take a random path from one circle destination, which is going to the shortest, but maybe necessary. Or it's a shortest path.
Okay, well, what do you so it's not trace here?
No, the trace are what they did to create the scenario that it's simulated.
So you could, have you tried to change the load for the system?
Yes, you did.
Yes.
Okay, and there is no dependency on load. Because you didn't show how does it, if it converge,
mm-hmm.
and if it converge until, under which traffic condition, if there are some hypotheses, it must be met, or?
It's difficult to change the load on the big scenario because it takes really a lot of time just to initialize. You have to create all the data structure, the memory allocation takes time, and so on, so it takes 5 hours to start. You don't change the load like this. Mm-hmm. On smaller scenarios, seems to be quite intuitive the way to work.
Thanks again.